about labor unions. So one might think that unions had quite an important role during the Trump glorious in moderating inequality and ensuring that labor got a decent slice of the pie. What role do you think unions might have in the future in trying to avoid the kind of dystopian path that we might end up on if the trends that you described continue?
That's a tough question, and probably the book doesn't do justice to this question, and you know doesn't deal enough with this question. You know, I guess it's interesting to see that in the past 10 years, you know, a number of countries that didn't use national minimum wages in the past did introduce national minimum wages. Britain and Germany is doing that as well. And you know, there's been an increased discussion in the US about using the federal minimum wage, I mean, which was introduced a long time before, but for a long time, which was not really increased so much. I think one reason for this sort of renewal of the national minimum wage is that in a world where you have growing employment in the services and declining employment in manufacturing companies, you know, unions don't quite have the bite and the impact that they used to. And so that doesn't mean that unions are not part of the solution, but that we also need to, you know, to think of other policies that have an impact on wages. So the minimum wage is one of them. Now, you know, investment in education, in skills is probably it's easier to have a high minimum wage if you have increased the skills and access to education and access to high paying jobs for the bottom segments of the population. So again, this is complementary. I think the issue of effective participation in company decision and in board shareholder meetings, you know, is going to be discussed more and more in the coming years, given in particular the success of Germany, and certainly I don't know for Britain, but in France. You know, it used to be the case that unions and workers would only have consultative vote on shareholders and board meetings. You know, they would not have a decisive vote. And now the new law is going to grant some limited number of decisive votes in boards, because it's always been like that in Germany, and in effect this gets the unions to be more closely associated to the management and the running of the company, and this seems to be working quite well in some ways. So all these issues are referred to in the book, but not sufficiently. Yeah, this I agree.
I suppose just finish, there's a sort of broader point here, which is that in the 20th century, the period where inequality was reduced, the organised working class, both through trade unions but through political parties and through its economic and political clout, gave energy and momentum to egalitarian movements, and the kind of decline of organised working class leaves a gap which progressive forces have found it very hard to fill subsequently. And I suppose this comes back to Martin's point that if you're to make these big arguments for reducing inequality, for introducing new taxes, for trying to democratise capital, where are the kind of societal forces that can sort of push behind progressive politicians? Because at the moment they don't appear to be there, and so they find it incredibly difficult to mobilise electoral coalitions behind those companies. You see this very obviously in France at the moment. That's a sociological question, I suppose, but it's for politicians who might agree with your analysis. So obviously they then think, well, how can I mobilise a coalition behind his solution? So that's a sort of more difficult task, isn't it?
Yes. So is Twitter going to be enough? That's your question. I'm not sure it's going to be enough. You know, I think there are new forms of mobilisation and mass participation that are yet to be invented. I don't have a full answer to that. Unions certainly do not belong to the past, but there are other forms of mobilisation that belong together with unions to the future, and which we don't fully know yet. So, I think I'm not as pessimistic as what you know, a number of observers and reviewers seem to believe after they've read this book. And you know, I'm very sorry if this made them pessimistic, because it's not. You know, I think you have also, you know, the development of you know, information technology and the internet also opens the way for, you know, new form of new ways of spreading the information, new ways of mobilization, and. Yeah, I guess I believe in the power of ideas and books and you know, I think this can also contribute, you know, to the diffusion of you know, information and to, you know, try to contribute to this. But yes, that's.
Well, if any ideas and books can have an impact, this certainly has, I think.